of Fox 31 Denver Memorial Day Special. On this sacred holiday, as our nation pauses to honor those who died defending their country, we are traveling back to the remote battlegrounds halfway around the world where the heroes of World War II made the ultimate sacrifice. These are not the killing fields made famous by photographs and folklore. These are the front lines that have been ignored by time and memory. The forgotten islands of World War II, a return to the hidden Pacific. Here's Fox 31 Denver anchor, Jeremy Hubbard.
Good evening and thanks for joining us tonight as we come to you from the island of Guam, some 7,000 miles away from home. If you looked at our location on a map, we're just a tiny speck in the middle of the vast Pacific Ocean, much closer to Japan than mainland US. And it's that proximity to Japan that made this such crucial real estate during World War II. Hard to believe that such stunningly beautiful places could be the scene of some of the most ugly and brutal battles back then, but they were. And so tonight we thought it'd be fitting to return here along with a Colorado charity that brings old soldiers back to the old battlefields where they once served. Old soldiers who were just kids last time they were here when they watched their friends die for their country.
Age. It tarnishes and fades. Rusts and withers. Age batters, leaves all things broken and brittle and falling apart. Unless you're talking about Ronald Rondo Scharf, graffiti artist, age 87 going on 16 and showing no signs of rust or tarnish at all.
Says Montana Rondo, World War II vet.
You've earned the right for some graffiti, right?
Don't waste your time reminding Rondo he's pushing 90. He's sliding into old age slowly. Maybe that's because he was still just a kid when he plunged into adulthood.
You grew up fast. You went in there as a kid and you come out a man.
Rondo hated high school back in Chicago, so at age 16, he saw opportunity and took it.
Well, my sister got married at St. Thomas Aquinas Catholic Church, and I speared about 6 or 7 baptismal certificates off the altar. And you could make it any age you wanted.
Fake documents in hand, he told the Navy he was of age, and he was off to join World War II.
Talked to Mom and Dad and told them I probably wouldn't be going overseas, so I'm about 18. That was a crock, because I was on Iwo in about 3.5 months.
Imagine him there at Iwo Jima, a 16-year-old, driving one of these Higgins boats loaded with 36 men, about to engage in the deadliest battle in the history of the Marine Corps. Rondo was hurt and his men were dying before they even made it to shore.
We hit an obstruction when we went into Iwo. We were in about 14 foot of water. I went over the top of the wheel and tore open my sternum, and it was a real cluster. A lot of the guys were over the side already. Some of them were in the water and they were drowning because they had their packs on and they couldn't get out. I remember looking over the side and I was telling myself, hell man, I'm 16, I can't be having a heart attack. I cannot be having a heart attack.
When you're 16 and witnessing hell on earth, it must feel like you're about to die. He was here on a tiny island, just 8 square miles in size, where nearly 7,000 of his fellow U.S. service members, some of them friends, would soon be killed.
Every day you think about stuff like that, you know, and every couple, 2, 3 weeks you have flashbacks, wake up sweating, and, you know, different things will set it off, like diesel fuel or loud noises, or certain things will set it off and it doesn't go away. Memories don't go away. There's good memories and bad memories.
It has been 70 years since Rondo last set foot on the Pacific Islands he helped liberate as a child. But he's back now with a group of 16 other World War II veterans, their journey paid for by a Denver charity, the Greatest Generations Foundation, that sends World War II veterans back to their old battlefields all over the world.
You got the easy way up there, huh?
And since Rondo was a kid last time he was here, this really is a chance to relive his youth.
You're going to be loading now.
I'm loading.
Not too often you see senior citizens doing this.
See these old men climbing tanks?
Or shuffling into a dirty old underground concrete cave where the Japanese used to hang out during the Battle of Guam.
Oh, you know, you'd like to think back and see what really went on in their minds and come walking in and see them all sitting around there It'd be totally different.
Part of the reason Rondo chooses to still take chances is because of his battle buddies who can't. It's something Rondo had a dream about just a few weeks ago.
I'm looking down, I'm standing over a couple of graves from my guys I knew. Why don't you guys come up for 30 days and spend the kind of life that I had and enjoy it and have a family and see what's going on in the world. But I mean, it's only going to be temporary, you guys. You come back in 30 days. Don't go AWOL on me.
The number of survivors like Rondo is dwindling fast. More than 400 World War II veterans die every day. So Rondo has a goal.
I'm going to beat you out, guys. I'm going to be the oldest World War II vet kicking.
To be the last man standing.
It's my goal. I figure I got 15 more good years, then I'll have to slow down.
He vows to be the oldest living World War II survivor while acting like the youngest.
That's a piece of cake, man. I can do it.
Vivid memories still unfaded after 70 years. When we come back tonight, a trip to a nearby island and one of the most beautiful places we've ever seen. A place where our veterans witnessed something so horrific they've never been able to forget it.
There were some of the most brutal battles of World War II. Saipan, Guam, Antinian. On this Memorial Day, we're traveling back to the forgotten islands of World War II, a return to the hidden Pacific. Here again from Guam is Fox 31 Denver's Jeremy Hubbard.
Welcome back tonight as we return to the battlefields of the Pacific with a Denver-based charity called the Greatest Generations Foundation. In the past decade, they've returned more than 2,800 World War II veterans to the places they served, places like Pearl Harbor and Normandy and Iwo Jima. We hopped a flight with them back in Denver and traveled halfway around the world to the Mariana Islands, some of the most crucial battlefields of World War II. Next up, the island of Saipan, where the stunning beauty stands in stark contrast to the ugly acts our veterans witnessed there.
It is an idea that is so hard to grasp. How could it have happened here, of all places? How could that deep blue sea have been stained red with the blood of thousands who jumped so willingly into the crashing surf below?
This is the suicide cliff that I remember because I saw him jumping into the water.
Ken Barkley vividly remembers witnessing it here at a place called Bonsai Cliff 71 years ago.
One of the absolute worst things I've ever seen in my entire life.
With the U.S. in the throes of World War II, Scooter, as they called him, joined the Army and was shipped off to the Pacific in 1943. And soon he was fighting in the Battle of Saipan. The Japanese had taken over the tiny island after World War I. The Americans wanted it in World War II because its runways would put bombers within range of Japan. A fierce month-long battle followed, leaving 24,000 Japanese soldiers dead. But the most tragic death toll was that of the desperate civilians on this island.
They were jumping into the water and there wasn't anything, I don't remember people necessarily trying to stop them. But somebody must have been doing it, and it was horrible. I mean, women and kids, and you see a lady with her baby in her arms jump off the cliff.
Japanese soldiers had told them horror stories about the American troops, said they'd be tortured and murdered. So instead of surrender, nearly every civilian on the island marched calmly, families in tow, to an oceanside cliff or a tall mountainside and jumped.
For Americans, that sort of thing was just sort of inconceivable.
Never mind what he encountered on the battlefield. It's those mass suicides that gave Scooter nightmares when he got back home.
I would wake up in the middle of the night and be screaming something or other. My mother would come running into the bedroom and, oh, yeah, Mom, I'm okay. You know, don't worry about it.
As one of the veterans traveling with our group told us,
that's the utmost of brutality.
War is never a good thing.
Never thought I'd see it again in my life.
But good things.
We couldn't get ashore because of the coral reef.
Came from this war and this place.
Very scary itself. for young guys like me.
At least for William Thompson, this is his first time back to the very beach where he was wounded. The very beach where remnants of his arrival still remain 71 years later. In the shallow waters of this lagoon, a few hundred yards offshore, there is still a half-submerged Sherman tank stuck in the coral reef, its barrel still pointing at shore.
I'm surprised that that tank is sitting out there, and it's been there all these years. Can you imagine?
Bill Thompson was 17 when he lied about his age to join the Marines. He was underage and overwhelmed, with his friends dying all around him on the beach here at Saipan.
Very sad, but wonderful to see that it's such a clear beach. You don't see a blood running all over it right now like you did back in those days.
He was injured in the face on day one of that battle, in the leg on day two. And on day eight, he was hurt again. That one was a life-changing injury. He was sent to a hospital in Seattle, where he met a girl from the USO.
She was kind of pretty and everything, so I says, well, how about a date? So she laughed at me, and she took me out on my first date on crutches. And from then on, that was my wife. I married her. She was married to her for 57 years. I raised 6 children, 4 girls and 2 boys. Thank you.
Thompson's wife died a few years back. He's 88 now and knows he will never return here again.
It's very coarse and very hard.
So he's taking home a memento, a piece of that coral that trapped him and his fellow service members offshore, directly in the line of fire. The coral that has lodged this old rusty tank off Garapan Beach for 7 decades now.
I want to take it back and let them know that this came from exactly where Daddy was all those many years ago, never thinking I'd ever get back here again.
And what a final return it has been, getting one last overhead glimpse of that beach down there below that forever changed his life.
My mother was sent to notice that I was wounded, nothing else. And it was quite a while before they let him know where I was and how I was.
And passing over the deep blue waters off Bonsai Cliff, that gorgeous landmark with such an ugly history. Every sight he sees below, another memory of the place that nearly cost him his life and claimed so many other lives a lifetime ago. Even for the guys who made history, who changed history, this little piece of history they're about to witness is captivating. Aboard a puddle jumper, the World War II veterans we've traveled to the Pacific with are making a 5-minute flight to an island that barely shows up as a dot on a globe. Ironic, considering the massive impact the minuscule island of Tinian had on our planet. Specifically, the impact this patch of pavement had.
This is where the Enola Gay took off from.
Runway Abel, the runway that won the war.
Some of the rocks that the Enola Gay left.
On Tinian Island in the Marianas, a B-29 named the Enola Gay prepared to make the first atomic bomb run.
Runway Abel was the departure point for this famous plane on a world-changing mission. The Enola Gay dropped a 9,700-pound atomic bomb on Hiroshima, and within days, the war was over.
I never dreamed I'd have the opportunity to see the runway that he used to go to Japan on. That's something, it's quite a revelation. I've done a lot of flying during my life, for many years, both military and civilian, but I never dreamed I'd see this runway.
Aviation holds a special place in Jack Holder's heart. He's one of the rare veterans who served in both the Pacific and European theaters during World War II as an aviation flight engineer in the Navy.
That's exactly right.
As he stands here staring for the first time at the very spot where Little Boy, that atomic bomb, was loaded for its mission.
They took off at 2:45 in the morning for the raid over Hiroshima.
He can't help but feel the weight of the decision to deploy it, killing 66,000 Japanese and injuring just as many.
And in turn, it saved many lives of ours, saved many U.S. lives. You know, if we had to invade Japan proper, there's no telling how many thousands of poor young men we would have lost.
No matter where you travel on this tiny island, you can't help but feel the big impact it had and feel reverence for the lives lost ending a war that spanned the entire globe, took 6 years to fight, and left by some estimates 56 million people dead between battle deaths and civilians. Death is something that eluded these guys when they were first here 70 years ago, but it is an encroaching reality now. Even the youngest of the veterans on our trip is pushing 90.
My name is Mickey Ganich. I am 95 years old. I was at Pearl Harbor when the war started in 1941 there.
So they're using the time they have left to honor the guys who didn't make it off these islands alive.
I landed on June 15th, 1944.
They're fallen friends.
I didn't go back for closure. Some people talk about closure. I didn't go back for that. I went back for the memories and to pay respects for my brothers that didn't make it back.
By teaching others something about World War II we may never have known before.
We served our country and we did it well.
Before it's too late to hear it firsthand.
Thank you very much.
We've spent 12 days with 17 guys who truly have put the great in the greatest generation. We were with them as they returned to the islands where they served and were hurt and nearly died in some cases as they helped win World War II. As we close out tonight, a look at some of the most memorable moments from our journey from Fox 31 Denver photojournalist Sean Toll.
We had a group of 17 World War II vets that went back to the islands where we originated from.
I'm 90 years old, about to be 91, and this is the crux, the crowning event of my life. We went to Guam.
Oh, but this is wonderful. What a place to be.
I'm sure that was mounted on the bow of the El Dorado. You don't know. No wonder you were going to be court-martialed.
We went to Tinian.
You don't know what it feels like to walk down this runway.
That bomb's taken up the whole length of the bomb bay there.
A lot of history here. Brings back a lot of memories.
No, I didn't know it was here. I'm really glad to get that photo.
Now, I know how Saipan is going to be. It's been so many years, 70 years, that's a long time ago. They'd come in, I'm scared to hell. There were jet battleships and cruisers were all out there. 81-millimeter mortars were shooting up in there.
I pray that we don't ever have to go through that again in my rest of my life.
Mr. Ronald Scharf.
Thank you, sir. More, sir.
It's sentimental. It's emotional. And as I say, you think after 70 years, it's hard to talk about it.
Doesn't seem like that 70 years went by in a whisper, but it did. It was an honor and a privilege to get to be back with so many old bros again.
He saved my butt.
And he did save your butt.
I never wanted to come back to this damn rock, but I'm glad I did, because now I know it really happened.
I know some Americans wouldn't have anything, wouldn't be here, some Marines I know. They hated it. I don't hate anybody, even if they took some of my hearing.
They didn't know what earmuffs was. They didn't know what earplugs was. That's the way you wearing them hearing aids now.
Those that went down with the first shot, think about them. I'm sure all of us do.
If I was dropped dead tomorrow, I would have done everything that I could have wanted to do.
I'm beginning to feel like I'm older than dirt. But the thing is, we're still here and we're still enjoying it, and it's a good life.
It was a wonderful trip, and we sure appreciated it. Take care. We'll drop anchor here, I guess.
A final emotional return for some great men from a great generation. I'm Jeremy Hubbard. Thanks so much for joining us tonight from the island of Guam. And on this Memorial Day, we say thank you to all the military men and women before and since World War II who have sacrificed so much. Have a great evening.
For more information on the forgotten islands of World War II, a return to the hidden Pacific, go to kdvr.com. You can also learn more about the Denver-based charity, the Greatest Generations Foundation, and the work they do returning U.S. veterans to the battlefields where they served. This has been a Fox 31 Denver News special.